In this video, I'm going to introduce you to Azure Storage Accounts. Hello everyone, this is Seraltos and I'm Travis. Storage accounts are an important part of Azure Cloud Services, and you will likely use them on your journey to cloud computing. In this video, I'm going to give you an overview of the characteristics and features of an Azure storage account. This is not intended to be a deep dive into storage accounts. There are many features included with a storage account, and most require their own video. This is a 100-level video that will cover the main features of an Azure storage account to help people new to Azure. Before we go on, I'm contractually obligated to ask you to subscribe, so please do so. So, what is a storage account? A storage account is a cloud repository for data. When I first started out with Azure, I made the mistake of equating it to a SAN or a NAS device. It is not like that at all. Matter of fact, it would be a mistake to think of it in terms of traditional block storage or file storage. Blob stands for binary large object. Blob storage is object-based storage used to store massive amounts of data. Blob storage consists of a single level of storage within a container. There is no true directory structure. However, paths can be emulated by creating blobs that contain the slash in the name. Also, blob storage is accessible by HTTP or HTTPS protocol, not SMB or NFS like traditional file servers. Any binary object can be saved to blob storage, including images or documents, media files, log files, backup or archive files, and virtual disk files. There are three types of blob storage intended for different uses. Block blobs, these are for text and binary data files. Existing blocks can be inserted, replaced, or deleted. Append blobs are optimized for append operations. When modified, blocks are appended to the end of the blob only. Use this if you need to track history of changes on blob files. Page blobs are a collection of 512-byte pages optimized for random read and write operations. This is what Azure VMs use for virtual disk because of the random nature of the reads and writes. Let's move on to locations and redundancy. Storage accounts are core components of Azure, and as such, they're available in each region. Azure also protects data by keeping replicas of the data in storage accounts to protect it from planned and unplanned outages. There are four redundancy options with different SLA guarantees available when deploying a storage account. First is local redundant storage, or LRS. There's multiple copies in one data center. This gives you 11 nines for the SLA. Next is zone redundant storage, or ZRS. With this, there's multiple copies of the data in multiple data centers within a region. Next is geo-redundant storage, or GRS. Multiple copies of data are kept in multiple regions. This ups to a 16 nines SLA. Read access geo-redundant storage, or RA-GRS, is the same as GRS, only you can read from those copies in other regions. The geo-redundant option copies data between paired regions. I went over paired regions in a previous video. You can find it in the link above here someplace. Keep in mind that these replicas are intended for Azure to meet the SLA for storage. It should not be considered a backup strategy. If there's data corruption, for example, that corruption will be replicated to all copies. Also, Microsoft controls when a failover to a replica occurs. That is not a user-initiated activity. Next, let's move on to access tiers. There are three access tiers in blob storage, each optimized for different data access and retention scenarios. Hot is for data that's accessed frequently. There's a higher storage cost, but a lower access cost. Think of this for a virtual disk. Cool is for data infrequently accessed. There's a lower storage cost, but a higher cost to access. And then finally, there's archive. This is for data rarely accessed. It has the lowest storage cost, but the highest access cost. There's also a delay in retrieving data if you need to call it back. You could equate this to like tape storage. The three options provide an economic data storage strategy based on how frequently that data is accessed. But wait, there's more. Storage accounts are not limited to storing blob files. There are other services available in a storage account as well. One being Azure Files. These are SMB shares backed by blob storage. Azure Files are secured by role-based access control, not NTFS. They wouldn't be a good option for user file, but if you have some services that need to access an SMB share, this may be a good option. Azure Queue Storage. This is a messaging service for storing large number of messages. Think of microservices that need to communicate with each other asynchronously. They could use queue storage as a broker or a queue for the messages. This is when queue storage would be used. And Azure Table Storage. This is a no-sql table data storage. Think of it as a large Excel spreadsheet. Azure Table Storage allows for uploading of large amounts of unstructured key value pair data. And then Azure Disk Storage. This is also known as managed disks. Disks can be created in Azure Blob Storage or as managed disks. Managed disks are more expensive, but offer more features and are simpler to manage. Let's move on to securing storage accounts. There are two ways to secure access to a storage account, with access keys or with SAS tokens. First is access keys. There are two per storage account, and those access keys give full access to everything within the storage account. The two keys allow for key rotation without disrupting access. Access to these keys should be limited because they grant full access. Really, if you're going to give people access to a storage account, the better way is through a shared access signature or SAS token. These are time-based access keys or token that give granular control. And we're going to demo that right now in the demo. All right, buckle up everyone, it's demo time. In this demo, I'm going to do two things. First, I'm going to create a storage account, and then we'll go through and look at some of the different options and settings that we talked about. Next, I'm going to create a SAS token that I'll use to connect to the storage account with Storage Explorer. So I guess technically that's three things, but well, let's get started. So the first thing we're gonna do is create a resource, and that resource is gonna be a storage account. And there it is. So I'll select this, I'm gonna create. Okay, so the subscription is gonna be pay as you go, that's my subscription. I'm gonna create a new resource group, we'll just call this demo storage. All right, so that's going to be a new resource group. And then for a storage account name, I'm going to give it a name. CIR test storage. The storage name does need to be globally unique because it is accessed by a URL. I'll leave East US 2 as the location. There's a couple performance tiers, standard and premium. I'm going to go with standard. I'll leave it as a storage V2. For replication, I'm going to leave this as LRS, but here you can see the different options available, LRS, ZRS, GRS, and read access GRS. And the default tier will be hot. So next I go into advanced. So secure transfer required, that requires HTTPS. Virtual networks, you can select if you want to allow access from all networks or a selected virtual network. I'll leave it at as all networks. Data protection, this is kind of interesting. You can enable soft delete. This puts any blobs that are deleted into like a recycle basket for 7 days by default, but you can turn that up if you want it. I'm just gonna leave it at 7. There we go. And I do not need data lake storage. So I'm gonna go to review and create because I'm not gonna use tags. And then I will create. And this is going to take a couple seconds, so I'll be back shortly. All right, that took about a minute to complete. I'm going to go to resources. And here we can see all that we talked about before. At the top is the standard Azure stuff, activity logs, tags. And then here under settings, we're going to come back to that. But here is the blob storage. And you can see I don't have a blob there, but let's create a container quick. I'm going to call this test container. And we'll click OK. That created a container that I can use to store blob files. There's a few other things in here. Again, this is more of a high level. Each one of these probably requires its own video to go over into deep detail, but I want to show also here's the file services, although there is none, but I could create a share here, table storage, and queues. So let's go back up. I want to show you two things here. First is access keys. Now, these are all blanked out. Let's see here. Okay, I'll enable these for now. And I don't mind you seeing these because this will be long gone by the time you see this video. But here you can see there's two keys as well as connection strings for each key. Now, these are the keys that will grant full access to this storage account. And I don't want to use those. What I want to use is the shared access signature. Here you can see I can get granular. I can disable or enable blob, file, queue, and table. I can also specify the allowed resources, allowed permissions, and we can also set a time, as well as allowed IP addresses. I can specify HTTPS only or HTTP and HTTPS. Now, if you remember back when I set up this account, I specified secure connections only, so HTTP won't work. And then I'm going to generate a SAS connection string, and it's going to generate off from that first key. I could select two if I wanted to, but I'm going to leave it as key one. Obviously, if I rotated key one, this would be no good. So here it's giving me a list of a lot of connection strings, SAS tokens, blob service SAS URLs, file service SAS URL, queue service SAS URL, and table service SAS URL. So if I wanted to interact directly with any one of those services, I could use these URLs. I'm going to grab this connection string though. And with that, I'm going to hop over to Storage Explorer. Now, if you haven't used Storage Explorer before, this is kind of like File Explorer, but for Azure Storage. You can download it from Microsoft. Just do a search for Microsoft Azure Storage Explorer, and you'll get the most recent version. From here, I'm going to connect, and I'm going to use this option, Use Connection String. Now, in reality, what I'd probably do is add the Azure account. That will just have me sign into Azure, and then I'll be able to see all my storage accounts. But for the demo, I'm going to show you how a connection string works. So I'm going to select that option. And then I'll go into connection string. And you can see I pasted the connection string in, and it came up with the display name, the CIR test storage. And then next, and then I'll click connect. There it is. Now I can go into that storage account, and you can see blob containers, file, queue, and table, because I selected the connection string that connects to all those services. If I go into blob, we can see my test container is there, and it is empty. But what I'm going to do is upload a file. I'm going to select just a test file that I have on the desktop. And I'll select upload. And there it is. So now the file is showing up in Azure Storage Explorer. Now I'm going to minimize this and go back to my storage account in the portal. And one thing I will note, all these will go away as soon as I exit out. So if I needed to come back and retrieve that, I would have to recreate a new connection string. I'm going to go into blob storage, or I'm sorry, blobs. We can see my test container. And there is the blob test.txt. Now, if I come over here, I've got a few different options. If I go to blob properties, you can see I have the option to create a snapshot. I can edit the blob, generate a SAS to that specific blob. So this would not be to the container or the storage account. This would be for the specific blob. If I go into overview, you can see I have optimized storage cost by placing your data in the appropriate access tier. That's set to hot because that's the default, but here's where I have cool and archive. So I could change that to archive if it was a file that I wasn't going to access frequently at all, and I just wanted to store it out there at the cheapest possible price. There you have it. That's an overview of creating a storage account, creating a SAS token, and using that token in Azure Storage Explorer to connect to the container. Cool. Okay, let's move on to some recommendations. First, safeguard that access key. You shouldn't give out the access key. You should only use the SAS tokens instead. Keep the storage accounts close to the resources that are using it. You wouldn't want a VM in East US using a disk that's located in a storage account in West US. Keep the storage account in the same resource group as services with similar lifecycle for organization and billing. Also, keep IOPS in mind. Each storage account has a limited amount of IOPS. You may need to spread resources such as data disk across multiple storage accounts for best performance. As I said in the beginning, this is not intended to be a deep dive into storage accounts, but this information should get you started with an understanding of what a storage account is, core features of storage accounts, and how to access them with stored access signatures. Thanks for watching. Please don't forget to subscribe and click the bell icon for notifications of new videos.